Thanks for being here. My work at AMD involves, I work in the drivers team, software drivers team at AMD, in the graphic GPU team. So basically, what we have is a lot of times we have driver testing. So usually what happens is when a new driver software comes in, we'll have to test it on different games and videos and images to see whether the driver is, there's no flicker and there's no, you know, user disturbance. So what was happening earlier was whenever a driver software was coming in, we had a lot of testers testing games and videos and images to see whether the driver is showing some flickering or not. And this used to take a lot of time. But now what we have done is we have used deep learning, particularly CNN and RNNs, so earlier suppose there was 10 testers doing 10 days of testing for a driver before release. Now it's almost like you can say we've completely automated the whole system. So we have images coming in, we give it to a model which is basically built on CNN and a little bit of, now we have moved on to RNN for video classification, but for images we are using CNN. So our image comes in, the software tells whether the image is good or not. So, and right now we have a false positive of almost 0%. So in fact, it gives an accuracy of 99.99. So that's a big takeaway. So this took around 3-4, probably 6 months for us to do that. I mean, basically we had to do a real-time pipeline and all that. So my talk here is basically, I'll be showing you a simple demo. I didn't want it to be like a theoretical session. So I want to show you the code. I'll be using TensorFlow to do this. And the thing here is, the thing about deep learning is, I'll show you the code, it's not more than 100 lines probably. What you're doing this in computer science, if you go back, this problem was not solvable 10 years back with this kind of accuracy. It's difficult to imagine a computer identifying an image. What we take for granted is a really difficult task. For example, even right now humans, I can say there are some images which humans also get confused. Like if you blur the image, it's hard to identify whether it's a dog or a cat, right? That's why you have autonomous cars failing right now, right? There are some signs which the autonomous cars can't read. But that's with humans also. No human can claim to say that I can identify images with 100% accuracy. So we have computers almost reaching the level of humans in terms of identifying images and accuracy. I think and the kind of, it's all because of algorithm, this sort of CNN algorithm. Earlier you had support vector machines and Gaussian models and all that which were getting close, but CNNs have beaten them hands down. So basically, so I'll run through the code and show you what we are doing. So you can see you can build a CNN with less than 100 lines of code. Okay. So the problem statement is, like I said earlier, we wanted to identify games. We wanted computer to identify games and images. Also, one of the things we are doing at AMD is we are doing video classification. For example, a video comes in, computer has to tell me which category it belongs to, whether it's a game, whether it's a movie video, something that YouTube does, right? YouTube personalizes your content, right? So if you've been watching cricket, for example, the moment you log into YouTube, you'll have cricket videos as recommended. How does it do it from millions of billions of videos? It uses something. It uses one of these things to do. So one of the things we are doing is for videos we are doing RNNs. And for images, we are doing CNN. So a standard workflow basically in machine learning is you have a set of images, training, testing, right? You have two sets of images, whatever the classification is, cats and dogs. You give it to you, you build a model, you send in the images, the model trains on it, then you go on changing your parameters to get the accuracy that you desire. Once the training has been done, you take away the model, then you can put it anywhere on the server. and then you go on, you deploy it anywhere, and then you start using it. So this is the basic workflow. Right, so just to give you a little background, this is what a basic CNN structure, most of you might be knowing this. I just thought, so the trick here is, so convolutions happen, why CNNs are so effective? Because you have something like 2D convolution happening. Everybody knows what a single dimensional CNN basically convolution is. In image, you have 2D convolution, so basically you have an input image which is 32 by 32, and then you have a set of convolution filters, right, and different layers. So what these filters do is extract some features from the image, and then, so the first part of the model here is the CNNs, and then what happens is your square image, which was 32 by 32, becomes flattened, and at the end of the output, you have a dense layer, which is basically a flat set of, it's an array of numbers. So you've started from a square image, you've extracted features through convolution, and then you've gone on and flattened the image. So basically, subsampling, what it does is it reduces your dimensions. So if you have 1,000 by 1,000 pixel images, it's 1,000,000, right? 1,000 into 1,000. From 1,000,000 into the weight, right? So your model blows up. So CNNs help you in better, compacting your models, right? So you have convolutions, pooling, flattening, and then again the full connection, which is this thing. So I want to get on to the hands-on thing, because that is what I thought I'll do, and I don't want to keep you waiting before lunch. So, okay, so. Okay, so I'm using Colab, okay? So Colab, for example, all of you, anybody who wants to try out GPUs, Google provides you no internet. I requested my internet. Walk you through the code. I'm using TensorFlow, right? And Colab. This is Colab, which is a cloud-based GPU, free for everybody. Thanks to Google, right? So you can go on. You can train your models now without buying GPU. AMD is not too happy because we sell GPUs. AMD makes GPUs. Google. I'll just show you, walk through the code basically, and you'll see how probably less than 100 lines of code you're doing a very, very difficult task, which was not possible 10 years back with all the computer science in the world. And that is, I think, amazing. So now, basically, I'm downloading a zip file, okay, which contains two set of images. The problem I'm trying to solve is, I have horses and I have humans. Yeah. So I have horses and humans. I want my software to recognize which image is a horse and which image is a human. So this directory, you'll have two sets of directory inside it. Horses and humans, okay? So in horses I have 500 images, and humans I have 500 images. So if I want to see the contents, I have files named. I've printed the 10 files here, horse and humans. Right, so and if you want to see, okay, so totally I have around 500 horses and 500 humans. You have to have a balanced data set, otherwise you get problems when you are doing so accuracy might be good, but when you deploy it on the system, your model has learned to, is biased. So you have to have equal number of classes, whatever you're doing. Okay, so let's see some of the images. Okay, so these are some of the images. Okay, it's a 300 by 300 into 3. 3 is because it's colored images, 300 by 300 into 3. So I have just displayed 8 horses and then humans. These are generated from this thing. Okay, so these are some of the images. With model, you have a flat layer, 512. And then finally, probability, this thing, whether it's a human or this final layer is 1. And then you have the standard ReLU and all that. And my input shape, as I said, is all the images will be resized to 300 by 300 into 3, right? So otherwise, if you give a 1,000 by 1,000, you have a bigger model, the training, all that problem happens. Okay, so this is the model being defined. Let's run the this thing. Okay, so this gives you the summary. So the initial layer is a convolution layer, then you have max pooling, convolution, max pooling, so on. Okay, and then you have these rows there. So now what happens, once you have a model defined, you compile it, the standard compilation happens. You have to give a loss, and then optimizer, you can use Adam, what's any sort of gradient descent optimization. Okay, so, right, so now the model was defined, and here you use a training, so even to label the data is very easy now with TensorFlow. You don't have to do it manually and all that. TensorFlow provides you image data generator. You just put your files in a folder. TensorFlow figures out the folder name as your label. So here I had two folders, right? In my temp directory, I had horses and humans. So that this directory I give as my train directory. From there, it figures out, okay, I have to classify two sets of images, horses and humans. So all that image data generator does that for you. Okay, so now this is actually the training part. So I've started training. So here you see, I've set an epoch of 15. And then there's something called callback, okay? You can set an accuracy. What happens is a lot of time beforehand, you don't know for how long you have to train your model. So you can write a callback. See, I have specified here that if my accuracy becomes greater than 99, stop the training. So you can do all that. Otherwise, earlier you would have to manually draw graphs and see when it is being optimized. So this is the most time-consuming part. So now the training start it takes 15 minutes, but I've saved my model for use before it, right? So I don't have to wait 15 minutes here. But you'll see now the epoch 1 is running. It has to go through, because I've defined 15 here, it has to go through 1, 2, 3, and then it will print you accuracy and what sort of all the metrics. Right, so this is being run here. Now I'll stop it because I don't have time, but you can see this goes on. Okay, I have saved my model for the presentation, so we'll use that one. Then you can plot your, since I stopped it, you can plot your errors, you can plot your, basically two metrics, these are the two important metrics that we look at, loss, how is the loss increasing with time, and how is the accuracy increasing with time. So you can plot that and you can see it here. But see, the core code is all the visualization and all that is, but the core code here is also not more than 50 lines, probably 40 or lines. Okay, so we'll use, I had saved a model called on this file here. We'll use this model. It's a pre-trained model, right? Once you train a model, you don't have to train it again and again because it is time consuming. I had saved the model. We'll use this and we'll see how it performs on a live input. Okay, so I've loaded this model. Oh, the model doesn't exist here. So what happens here is you have a model, right? You get the input from your system, and then you give it. This is the deep learning model that you have, and then you feed it in a feed as image that you've gotten from your computer, and then it predicts the class. So if you see here, I have what I'm doing here. If the probability of prediction is greater than 0.5, then it's a human. Otherwise, it's a horse. And so this part is basically deployment or testing. The same logic can be put on a server or anywhere. So basically a model can be saved in a HY file or a NumPy file, and then you can just take it on a pen drive and deploy it in any of the servers. And then you can serve it from your AWS or whatever, any sort of cloud, this thing. I would have shown you a demo, but right now this is. And then I wrote this code to show you what happens in each of the layers. For example, how convolution, if you break it down layer-wise, how convolution neural network extracts features from layer-wise. So it's a, usually they say that deep learning is a black box sort of problem, and to a certain extent it is. You don't know how a computer actually learns, we know some parts of it, like for example, it learns from various aspects, but still you have to do a lot of parameter tuning. For example, what should be your what should be the number of epochs, how many images, what sort of decent optimization algorithm that you have to use. So these things come through training, and a lot of it is intuitive. You keep working and you're trying and you keep going back and tweaking stuff and getting to the output. A lot of it has come through experience and also through trial and error. So you can't tell beforehand, okay, you take these number of images, you set it like this. It's not like a standard thing. Some parts of it, for example, somebody might ask, okay, why did you use, if I go back to my model, okay, so the, why did you use, for somebody might ask, okay, why did you use the four, so I've used five convolution CNN layers, right? 16, 32. Somebody might ask, why five, why not four, why not six? Other question might be, why 16 filters, why not 32, right? And why 3x3, 2x2? Why should the input size be 300x300? Why not 250x250? So you don't have the answers are you keep trying, right? So the numbers which give you the best performance, you freeze on those numbers. Till then you keep trying. And that is where a lot of time goes in. So you don't have a golden set of rules. There are some guidelines, best practices, right? There are, for example, when you're writing Python code, you're supposed to follow those guidelines, or any sort of programming languages, right? You name your classes properly, you name your functions properly. So those rules are there. But then that is why also machine learning and deep learning is a difficult task to teach students, right? As a when somebody asks you why you're doing a lot of stuff, you just tell them, okay, people, the papers that were published recommend these sort of things, but they're not necessary that they'll perform for the problem that you are trying to solve, right? The same model might not do as well for you, right? So for example, a lot of times you'll have to decrease the, okay, and here you have max pooling. There's no dropout layer. For people familiar with overfitting problems in deep learning, you need to have dropout layers. Dropout layers randomly remove the nodes, right? I don't have any dropout layers because this works fine for me, right? So if there was a problem of overfitting means you have, your model is doing very well on the training data, but on the testing data, it's not that accurate. So when you have those sort of problems, then you do regularization, L1, L2, and you have max pooling layer, you have dropout layers for that, right? So I would have showed this. I had a graph showing this on my code, but my model is not loading. So this is how a convolution CNN learns. Okay, so some of the layers. So you have different layers, right? Each layer learns different part of the feature. For example, high level features are learned at the last layer. So the initial layers learn the low level features, and then you have. So you have nose, ears, a human being's image has all these aspects, right? So different layers learn different parts of it. And it's a black box because it's very hard to define how it happens. You know what is happening, but whys are very difficult to answer completely. Like, so a lot of hand waving happens. Even for professors and people who are into deep learning researchers, if you ask them a lot of whys, they know it works and they know they can explain you parts of it, but a lot of things, it's a black box. You feed in stuff, you get output. And that is where the future of research is happening in deep learning. How to make it more transparent and, this sort of thing. Okay, thanks. I'll just last slide. And I was talking earlier, right? You have traditional machine learning models, statistical models, and then you have deep learning, right? Deep learning basically neural networks. So if you see CNN by far, and this performance is pretty old. So right now CNNs are the state of the art for any sort of computer vision problem, autonomous cars and image recognition. It's unanimous that CNNs beat all the other algorithms hands down. The closest that was earlier was SVM, support vector machine and Gaussian kernel. Right, so the lower, this is the error rate, the lower the better, right? So this is how one of these are some of the comparisons that you can see there. Right, then this is how generally your training graph looks like. So when you're training, you're supposed to get this is the number of epochs, and then you have the accuracy. So you start off somewhere around 70%, and then it goes on increasing. So ideally, the arrow points that you have to stop your training after 10 or 12 epochs. Otherwise, the accuracy goes down. Right. So this is where the callback comes in. With TensorFlow, you can provide a callback, it'll stop automatically. So you don't have to worry about how many epochs. One of the hyperparameters goes down, right? And here you have the problem of overfitting. You have blue is the training data, and yellow is the validation data that you had, right? So once the curve, both curves should go in parallel. What is happening there is if you go on training further, your performance, this is what we care about, the yellow, how it performs in the test data. Your accuracy goes down. So that is the overfitting model. Okay, thanks.